So I want to make a hexapod. A cheap hexapod. They look interesting and are a great starting point for something that works because they are stable. I'm going to split this into multiple videos because there's just so much to cover. In this one, I'll talk about inverse kinematics and how to make a hexapod leg walk. In the next video, I'm going to make the whole hexapod and hopefully have it walking and running all over the place. And in the final video, I'm going to make the hexapod remote control.
Welcome to Just Another Maker channel.
So, how do we make a hexapod walk? It all comes down to inverse kinematics. What is inverse kinematics? Well, kinematics is about the motion of objects. So the kinematic part is we want to move this from here to here. The inverse in this sense is the how do we get from here to here. I'm going to go through the inverse kinematic solution and then I'll demonstrate it working along with some of the mistakes I found while doing this and give a quick overview of the programming code at the end. Now if we take the hexapod we are hopefully going to make, and first we say this is the front, this is the leg we are going to focus on for our inverse kinematic solution. We define our coordinate system. So this is our x-axis, this is our y-axis, and this is our z-axis. I know this might seem a little bit strange, but this coordinate system is used commonly with industrial robots. Ultimately, the letters x, y, and z don't matter. They could be called A, B, C, or rock, paper, scissors, but we'll stick to x, y, z. It can also be easily remembered using our right hand, like so, with the fingers pointing in the positive direction. So if we put this to one side and look at our hexapod leg from the side, it's controlled by three micro servos. We will label these as joint 1, J1, J2 and J3. To try and make it as clear as possible, here is our hexapod leg from the side and from above. Here is our coordinate system. J1 is underneath here and rotates like this around the z-axis. J2 rotates like this around the x-axis, and J3 rotates like this in essentially free space, but we'll get to that in a minute. First, we're going to solve a 2D inverse kinematic solution for J2 and J3 with our leg in the rest position as it is shown. Ultimately, we are trying to control where the foot of the leg is placed, this point here. Now we can draw a triangle through the centre of J2, J3 and the point we want the foot to be at. We need to know the angle for J2 relative to the y-axis and the angle of J3 relative to J2. We know the length of the J2 segment is 57mm in this case, which we will call J2L. And the length of the J3 segment is 110mm, which we will call J3L. We need to calculate the length of the remaining side. For now we will call this L. We can calculate L using the following triangle and Pythagoras theorem. We already know the other sizes of this triangle because it's where we want to position our foot in Y and Z, and we know that Y is at right angles to Z. Pythagoras' theorem tells us that the square of the hypotenuse, L in this case, is equal to the sum of the square of the other two sides. Here that is Y squared plus Z squared. So the length L is equal to the square root of Y squared plus Z squared. Now we can solve for the angle J3 using the law of cosines. The law of cosines tells us that to find the angle D for a triangle where we know the lengths of all three sides, that D equals the inverse cosine of A squared plus B squared minus C squared divided by 2 multiplied by A multiplied by B. So to solve for J3, we can just substitute our values, which gives us J3 equals the inverse cosine of J2L squared plus J3L squared minus L squared divided by 2 multiplied by J2L multiplied by J3L. All that remains is to find J2. For this we need to find two more angles, which we will call A and B. To find angle B, we can just use the law of cosines again and just substitute our values in, which gives us this. Angle A is also present here in this triangle. To find angle A, we need to use some simple trigonometry. There are three trigonometric ratios for right angle triangles. In this example, we need to use the tangent of angle A equals the opposite side Z divided by the adjacent side Y. However, we want to find the angle so we can rearrange this to angle A equals the inverse tangent of the opposite side Z divided by the adjacent side Y. And finally, to solve for J2, it's simply angle B minus angle A. And that's all there is to it. Now to 3D print some parts and assemble them. I've designed the 3D printed parts so that I can glue the servo horns into them. One of the key things to assembling this is to make sure that the servos are at a known position. Here I am turning the servos back and forward to try and find the center point of their movement. I use a two-part glue. It's actually mitre adhesive. It's a CA glue and spray activator that makes it set quickly. It seems to work quite well with the printed PET. To secure the servos, I'm just using the self-tapping screws that came with them. The 3D printed parts do have some 1mm holes printed into them, though they seem to have closed up slightly during printing. This servo doesn't seem to want to turn. Unfortunately, it's broken fresh out of the box. Now everything moves nice and smoothly. I'm just going to tie these cables up nicely out of the way and we can get testing. So here I have the J2 and J3 servos wired up to an Arduino Nano. Let's download some code that uses our inverse kinematic solution and see what happens. The leg should start at the rest position and move 100mm in Y. Well, that didn't quite go as planned, so what went wrong? Multiple things went wrong all at once, and they are related to how it's assembled and how the servos are controlled. Firstly, because we're using servos, the range of motion is 0 to 180 degrees. So 0 degrees for J2 in our kinematic solution is directly along the y-axis. But for our servo, that is 90 degrees. So to get the required servo angle, it is equal to 90 minus our calculated J2 angle. The next issue is that if I'm asking this to move to y equals 40 and z equals 0, which in our solution is roughly here, but in reality, I want this to be relative to the foot, assuming this point is our rest position. So all we need to do is apply some offsets, say 90mm in Y and minus 60mm in Z. So when I say go to Y equals 40 and Z equals 0, what we really do is calculate the solution for here, Y equals 90 plus 40, which is 130, and Z equals minus 60. The other key element with J2 is angle A. Because our resting Z offset is negative, angle A is negative. J2 equals B minus A, so B minus A ends up being B plus A, because two negatives become a positive, so we need to invert the minus in our solution to a positive. J3 is a completely different kettle of fish. We calculated the angle of J3 relative to J2, but our servo is not mounted in line with our foot, so we need to measure this angle from our design and add it onto our J3 solution. Now, in order to maximise the range of motion available, I fitted the servo horn here when the servo is at 90 degrees. This means we need to subtract 90 degrees from whatever we calculate to find the correct servo position. So we can see that with the changes, we can request 40mm movement in Y. And also 40mm movement in Z. Now that we have Y and Z working with J2 and J3, we can look at X and J1. This is actually quite simple. If we take a look at our hexapod leg from the top, it looks like this, and it operates within the X and Y coordinates. If we assume we want to move the foot to this point here, then we simply need to find this angle, which, as we've seen earlier, can be done using trigonometric ratios for right angle triangles. Angle J1 equals the inverse tangent of the opposite side X divided by the adjacent side Y. But by adding J1 into our solution, we need to adjust the solution for J2 and J3, because they no longer operate within the Y and Z axis, but operate along this line here, which we'll call H. We can calculate H using Pythagoras again, which gives us this. So now we just go back to our J2 and J3, and we can swap Y for H here, 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 and here, and that's it. Our inverse kinematic solution is finished, and it looks like this. 40mm forward in X, 40mm. You might have noticed that while we end up in the right places, our leg doesn't get there in a straight line. The reason is because our servos all need to move different angles. And by only commanding them to go to the end position, they all start at the same time, and some of them get there first because they don't have as far to travel. So to fix that, we need to use interpolation. Instead of commanding our servos to move all the way to the end in one go, we split this up into separate moves, and each move, it will still hop, but the more moves we split it up into, the smaller the hops, and we can achieve a straight line. So now we can make it go where we want, how we want. We can make it do this. Here is an example of it drawing straight lines with 10mm spacing. Unfortunately, there are a number of factors that make the lines not truly straight, like the dead band of the servos, the inertia of the arm, friction between the pen and the paper, and just the general cheapness of the servos. Nonetheless, I still think this is pretty impressive. Here is a short walking animation that I plan to use for the finished hexapod. In theory, the legs will move in two groups of three for normal walking, so I'll need to transpose these values to suit the legs that aren't perpendicular to the body of the hexapod. But that's for another video. The code for this is all quite straightforward. All of the hard parts have been covered earlier in this video, but it essentially comes down to these 9 lines of maths. There is a link in the description so you can download the code yourself and use it or adapt it for any of your projects. I hope you found this video interesting and informative. In the next video, I'm going to stick 6 of these onto a base and get a hexapod running around.
Thanks for watching, guys. Don't forget to like, comment and subscribe. See you in the next one.